The views expressed on the following paid program do not necessarily represent those of the ownership or management of Channel 11. This is your NFO Midwest Farm Report, brought to you each Sunday at this time on Channel 11 TV by the National Farmers Organization, which is completing its 10th year as a major farm organization in its effort to improve the lot of every family-type farmer. Today we have a panel of speakers whom you will meet in just a moment, selected to bring you a penetrating analysis of the factors involved in the aims and activities of the National Farmers Organization, which you also know under the name of NFO. The appearance of these panelists does not necessarily constitute an endorsement of the aims and activities of the National Farmers Organization. Similarly, the views expressed by the panelists are their own and do not necessarily reflect the views of the National Farmers Organization. Today we present a panel including four members representing the public. These four members are Mr. Wilbur Baton, President, the Bank of West Appear; Mr. Robert R. Flatley, attorney and presently assistant district attorney for Brown County and recently elected district attorney; Mrs. Esther Trudell, homemaker from Green Bay; and Mr. Harry R. McMahon, historian, philosopher, lecturer, and analyst. Now representing the Brown County chapter for the National Farmers Organization are four well-known individuals: Mr. Irvin Ambrosius, president of the Brown County chapter; Mrs. Arlene Menon, public relations manager; Mr. Peter Bethke, the chairman of the Dairy Bargaining Committee of Zone 4 in the Wausau marketing area, and also chairman of the Dairy Bargaining Committee for Brown County; and Mrs. Laverne Burt, secretary of the Brown County chapter. And finally, to moderate the proceedings of the panel, we introduce Mr. Oliver Menon, your moderator.
We know who the panelists are as individuals. It would be interesting to know why they are interested and involved. First, let's ask the public member why they are interested. We'll start with Mrs. Trudell.
Well, as a consumer and a homemaker, I am vitally interested in the price of food for my family. Someone said recently that if corporation farming takes over the food production in this country, prices will jump 40 to 50%. If this happens, I will have trouble feeding my family. So I am very, very concerned.
And next, Mr. Baton, we'll see what he has.
Because the Deep Care area is made up of family-type farms, I am deeply concerned with the elimination of the family-type farmer from the picture. A large portion of our business is dependent on the family-type farmers, and I can assure you we are deeply concerned about their welfare. We, in the Deep Care area, must preserve the family-type farm if our community is to survive.
Now, Mr. Flatley?
Well, for better or for worse, this effort at collective bargaining is going to have an important effect on public affairs in our area in the future. As district attorney, I believe I have a duty to try to understand the methods and objectives of this collective bargaining effort and to work to avoid possible violations of the law. And, of course, as an individual, I'm concerned about possible price rises in food costs.
And finally, Mr. McMahon?
When the family-type farms are being destroyed at the rate of 632 farms a day, I am greatly concerned, too, both because these dispossessed people are people and also because they pose a problem for all of us who live in cities and towns. When the family-type farmer is forced off the land, he must, of course, come to town, and he's coming in to compete for employment. But in addition, if he is penniless, then he becomes a burden to our already heavy welfare caseload. And even if he does have money, we must produce and provide for him additional urban facilities, such as water supplies, sewage supplies, recreation, schools, and fire protection, police protection, all the other urban services that takes when a population increases. So the impact of this inevitable overload on our services forces me to show great interest.
Let me ask one question which I know is in the minds of many viewing today. Is this collective bargaining effort legal?
Yes, it is. The collective bargaining effort is authorized by the Capra-Volstead Act, which was passed by Congress in 1922. This act provides that the producers of agricultural products, such as farmers or dairymen, may act together in collective marketing of their products by forming associations. Now, these associations must operate for the mutual benefit of their members and must conform to one of the following requirements. either that no member may be allowed more than one vote, regardless of the amount of stock or membership capital he may own, or that the association cannot pay dividends of more than 8% per year. Also, the association may not deal in the products of non-members in an amount greater in value than the value of the amount of the products handled by it for its members. The Kapper-Volstead Act also provides that if the association monopolizes trade and interstate commerce to such an extent that the price of any product is unduly raised, then the Secretary of Agriculture, after following certain legal procedures, including a hearing, can issue an order directing the association to cease and desist from monopolization or restraint of trade. In addition, the United States Supreme Court has held that the Kapper-Volstead Act does not replace the Sherman Antitrust Act, and a farm organization can be prosecuted under the Sherman Act if it engages in practices against others in order to monopolize trade or restrain or suppress competition. Thus, while the Kapper-Volstead Act does give the farmers the right to bargain collectively, there are restrictions and safeguards to protect the public from any abuse of these rights.
Well, that is the legal basis of collective bargaining effort. Now turning to the representatives of the National Farmers Organization, who are you in the big farming picture? First, Mrs. Burt.
We and the family-type farmers generally are the little people in the farming business.
Mrs. Menon?
Well, similarly, we are the left-outs and the lose-outs in the working of the benefits of the other farm organization.
Mr. Betke?
We are the NFO bargainers with the processors. We have secured and are securing processor contracts with a pricing structure. Hope to activate same to provide orderly marketing for our products.
Mr. Ambrosius, comment.
We are the membership organizers, and we have recruited our friends and neighbors into the NFO. We invite all family-type farmers and dairymen who have not joined to investigate the advantages and benefits in joining and helping us in our efforts to secure a collective bargain for all family-type farmers.
Do you have any additional comments, Mrs. Burt?
Yes, I do. We are a bargaining organization exclusively for producers.
Well, what is that you want? In other words, what do you seek? Mr. Ambrosius.
Well, what we want, in other words, what we seek, well, we want cost of production plus a reasonable profit to improve the working conditions in the lot of our own families and the families of other family-type farmers, all without injuring anyone.
Mrs. Burt?
We want to live and let live.
If all you want is to live and let live, then the question becomes, why can't you do it? Let's ask our economists, members on the panel, to describe the economic conditions which affects the aims and activities of the NFO. Mr. Baton.
Well, the economic trend of the times is destroying the family-type farm. The price-cost squeeze is forcing the little people out. For example, they cannot afford to buy the large machinery with which to cut the cost. Another example, in 1945, there were in round numbers 6 million family-type farms. Today, there are only 3 million. In a few more years, it is estimated that there will be only 1.5 million. Several years ago, there were typically 4 families farming on a section, each one making a living. Today, there are only 2, and in the tomorrow, as projected, there will be only 1. In other words, the economic trend of the times has already destroyed 3 million family farms of the 6 million that we had at the beginning of the period. And this trend will destroy half of those family farms which remain today unless the trend is checked. This means half of the family type farmers who are listening today will be out of the farming business if the trend goes unchecked.
Are there any destructive or unfavorable factors? Let's ask Mr. Ambrosius.
Yes, there are certain social economic factors that are destroying the family type farm. First, there are people who make money even when the family-type farmers go broke. For example, the big landholder who gobbles up the land and over-increasing cooperation farm crowd, and members and employees, and especially the manager of the rival farm organizations and supply services, public officials, column writers, TV commentators, who are in sympathy with big agribusiness. Example, one food chain made $100 profit per carcass on beef last spring, while the feeders lost $100 per head. Leasing corporations in Iowa formed to capitalize on cooperation farming.
Are there any positive or favorable factors?
Yes, just as the economical trend is unfavorable, the one sociological trend is favorable. All over the world, the little people are successfully improving their lots. But also, the very importantly and politically trend, that atmosphere is the most favorable in many years. Incidentally, it is not the cost factor alone that is destroying the family-type farmer. Rather, it is the price and marketing factor, because in the past and to a large extent, even to the present, the farmer, when he gets ready to sell his product, must sell at auction in the captive market. Since he cannot influence the selling price, he is in effect at the mercy of the organized buyer. So it is the family farm marketing situation, even more than the cost situation, that is destroying the family type farm. Another favorable factor is shown in the famous Wisconsin study that the average gross farm income of NFO members in Wisconsin is $15,580, compared to $12,830 for the second farm organization and $8,890 for the third farm organization. Similarly, the average farm acreage for NFO members in Wisconsin is 242 acres, compared with 181 acres of the non-members. The number of dairy cows for the average NFO members is 33 and 3 tenths, compared with 24 and 7 tenths for non-members. The average number of market pigs is 73 for the NFO member, compared with 23 for the non-members. And the percent of selling market pigs for NFO members is 65%, compared with 34% for the non-members. These figures mean that the average NFO members in Wisconsin is a bigger operator than the average non-member, so that our bargaining representatives have a larger bargaining base because it will represent the larger operator NFO members.
Mr. McCann, let me ask you a question. Why don't you significantly consider supply and demand?
Well, I'm not an economist as such, and so I cannot answer your question completely, but I can give you some clues. First of all, there is a basic general relationship between supply and demand on the one hand and the price on the other. But this relationship is not as ironclad as you and I were taught when we studied economics in school. There are some amazing developments that turn up. Let me show you what I mean. Long about 10 years ago, one of your fellow bankers down at Audubon, Iowa, dreamed up an operation called Operation T-Bone, in which he talked a whole bunch of feeders into producing and shipping, marketing all at one time, all of the fat cattle in the community. Now, I was down there on one of these Saturdays when they were loading out, and they loaded out 45 carloads, which would be about 1,000 cattle. Now, the cattle reached Chicago on the following Monday morning, and the normal workload in Chicago is about 10,000. So that means that on this particular Monday, instead of having 10,000, they had 11,000. Now, you're asking me, so let's find out here. What do you think happened to the price?
Well, the price should fall.
Yes, indeed. The price certainly should fall. But did it? No, it did not. On the contrary, the price went up and went up sharply. And my friends at Audubon were very pleased because they figured they'd struck a bonanza, and they had. Now, this has been going on every year since. And while I have not watched this every year since, every year that I have watched it, every year, without exception, with an overload on the market always goes up and has never gone down. And I have not watched this every year, but I did talk with one of the feeders at Audubon who participates in this program, and he told me that he has never failed to avoid a down market, and on the contrary, he has never failed to hit an up market on the first Monday of November every year. Now, does that give you some clues to why I do not rely completely on the law of supply and demand?
Yes, but, can you give me a clearer example?
Well, I think I can. You know, about 2 years ago, I was driving down through the country on a Wednesday afternoon with my car radio turned on and listening to a Clear Channel 50,000-watt station, being the farm editor. And he was remarking a very remarkable situation on exactly this subject. He told us that there had been and was in progress a holding action. And the holding action was 3 days old, but it had absolutely no effect on marketing. Receipts were normal, slaughtering was normal, so the supply of meat was normal, and there was no panic buying on the part of the housewife consumers. So you and I would think the price probably should have stayed right, pretty much an even keel, fluctuating a little up and a little down. Is that right?
That's right.
Well, amazingly, and this reporter told me this because I was listening, instead of staying nice and pretty level like we thought it should here, in 3 days, the retail price of beef jumped up from 20 to 40%. And he was concerned, so he telephoned some members of the meat trade and asked them why. And they said, there's no reason for it. Supplies are normal, receipts are normal, slaughtering is normal, and there's no panic buying, so it shouldn't have gone up at all, but it did. And continuing here, the price leveled off at the high level here. It went across for quite a long time. And I was listening to him again about 4 weeks later, and he announced that the holding action ended. Now, bear in mind, it was the holding action that caused the price to go up in 3 days. So when it ended, what should have happened to the price?
Well, it should have went down in 3 days.
It sure should. But did it? No, it did not. On the contrary, the price went down in 3 months. And again, about at the end of this period over here, I was listening to the same farm editor who again communicated with the meat trade to find out why. And again, they said there was no reason for it. It shouldn't have acted that way at all. But the meat that was being marketed through the producing, the distributing chain at that time, was in strong hands. Now again, I want to make clear that as an amateur economist, I do hold for the general relationship between supply and demand on one hand and pricing on the other. But it's obvious to me, and I think it's evident to you, that there are days like in Chicago, weeks like this place here where the price went up 20 to 40% in 1 week, and even months when it should have gone down, but it didn't, when the law of supply and demand does not have universal validity. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Well, let's ask whether the NFO has had any success in this first 10 years. Mr. Betke.
Yes, certainly and definitely. First of all, in 1955, there were 10 new farm organizations starting in the farm field, of which NFO will be the sole survivor in as far as we know. Next, we've had 3 successful holding actions, one more effective than the one before. We have learned how to organize, how to get processor contracts, and how to work together.
Mrs. Menon?
Well, I'd like to say that we have had recognition from national and state leaders like Senator Proxmire, Congressman Okonski from Wisconsin, Governor Hughes of Iowa, Senator McGee of Wyoming, and Senator McGovern of South Dakota. Also, a column writer wrote before the election that if the administration were returned to power, the NFO would become the voice of agriculture, replacing the rival farm organization which has dominated the farm legislation for many years. Incidentally, in the Milwaukee Journal Tuesday, Samuel Lubell said that this election reflected a farm revolt that started 10 years ago.
Let me break in with the question. What is this recognition you say you have from Congressman Okonski?
Mrs. Burt, you have that letter from Congressman Okonski?
Yes, I believe I have it here, and I will read it. Quote, I wish to state that the National Farmers Organization, in my judgment, is the only farm organization that is getting to the root of the farm problem, unquote. And the letter continues, but if you're asking about Senator Proxmire, he spoke in our behalf some programs ago.
And also, interest in and out of the membership of the NFO and the membership itself are at an all-time high. So we have had considerable success this first 10 years.
I would like to ask Mr. Bethke. I think he mentioned something about this holding or withholding action. Just what is this action?
Well, if you will, please, Mrs. Trudell, let me correct your term, withholding. Withholding means to refrain from granting. This is why we use the term of a holding action. By banding our production together, we remain unbroken or unsubdued by the processor. This is why we employ a holding action to get contracts, and these contracts will get us a price. Our whole objective, therefore, is based on securing contracts and activating the same.
Well, then, just why do you have to have this holding action?
Well, processors do not actually believe that the farmers really want to bargain collectively. They hope to keep each farmer as an individualist. When farmers, both members and our cooperating non-members, do collectively hold their products off the market in a holding action, the processors can then see that the farmers mean to bargain collectively, and at that point, the processor will bargain in good faith.
Well, if the holding action continues, just how will this affect our food prices?
We must first consider that our bargaining effort is solely with the processor and not with the consumer. At no time do we want to empty the shelf to the consumer. Our efforts are only to deplete the supply available to the processor. And when the processor bargains in good faith, we cease holding. However, as the attorney stated, if and when the end product of a holding action should affect the consumer adversely, then the Kapper's-Volstead Act empowers the Secretary of Agriculture to intervene and protect the consumer.
Well, then, just how would this affect the price of, let's say, bottled milk?
Bottled milk? Well, back in 1946 and 1948, the consumer paid 16 and 18 cents a quart. Today, the consumer is paying 22 to 24 cents a quart for it. Now, back in 1946 and 48, at that time, the farmer got 10 cents a quart. And for that same quart of milk, sold for 16 and 18 cents. Today, the farmer is getting 7 cents a quart, and he's paying 22 to 24 cents for it. But the payment, to me, has gone down from 10 cents to 7 cents. Do you see why we are not happy?
I'd like to ask Mr. Baton a question. As an economist, do you have anything on the wages received by the dairymen, the cattle feeders, or the grain farmers?
Yes, I have. A United States Department of Agriculture report gives official figures on this. The return per hour for farmers in given areas are as follows. Now, the wheat farmer with $110,000 invested receives 56 cents per hour. Now, that's in the winter wheat area of Southern Plains. The dairy farmer with $43,400 invested received 42 cents per hour. Now, that's in the central northeast. Beef raising and hog fattening invested $58,920, received 20 cents per hour in the Corn Belt area. Beef fattening and hog fattening with $98,920 invested lost, and I repeat, lost 54 cents each hour in the Corn Belt area.
Well, what can you do then to gain continuous success in this deal here, Mr. Moses?
Well, what we can do, organize and get additional membership and gain additional bargain representation for even greater portion of the total farm production.
I would say, as a bargainer, to organize, get more producer contracts so as to exert greater bargaining power. And, of course, activating these contracts.
We must change the public image so as to get support from the little people in the public whose economic problems are basically the same as ours. Each member can do this by knowing his organization and by knowing his membership contract and by knowing the processor's contracts and by knowing all of our aims. Also by telling our story to the public and by getting news of our activities on the news media, and by having capable speakers hit the luncheon circuit. In short, by presenting our story most favorably and more often.
Let me ask, can you proceed with your bargaining efforts without violence?
Violence? Well, in the last holding action, I was in contact with the sheriff and the district attorney almost continuously. We had no violence on the part of the members of the NFO, but therein, mind, if you have a crowd of people in contention, some members and some non-members, all of the people present must be peaceful. if you are to avoid violence. If one individual, for example, if one person, like a non-member, throws one punch, then you have violence. We cannot control all the members of the public. We can only control the membership. Let's say the state of the said to the sheriff and that the district attorney that I am the National Farmers Organization, more or less daily down, we do not condone violence. We do not engage in violence. We do not want violence. And if the matter rested with us, we will have no violence.
Well, to summarize it all up, let's see what the members of this panel get out of this discussion here. Mrs. Trudell?
Well, I am really very surprised at the stalemate. The farmers, have been forced to keep themselves. And also at the example you gave to me, Mr. Ambrosius, on the price of milk as we pay it for it and the price you sell it at. I think that takes care
of me. Mr. Flatley?
I'm glad I had the chance to study your organization in relation to the Capra-Volstead Act. As a district attorney, I can neither approve or disapprove of your objectives. However, I am anxious to work with your group to avoid situations that might result in possible criminal violations. And as long as you operate within the frameworks of the Capra-Volstead Act and with no injury to other people and no violence, it would appear to me that your methods and activities are legal under both federal and state laws.
Mr. Beaton.
I am pleased to hear these views and to find that so many other people are thinking about a problem that has worried me as a banker in a family farm community.
Mr. McMahon.
I am amazed to find that the Capra-Volstead Act was written in 1922, long before the flood of farm legislation we had later during the Depression years. And I'm also amazed to wonder, and I do wonder, why it had to exist 33 years before anyone thought seriously of using the provisions of the Capra-Volstead Act along the lines that you are proceeding on collective bargaining.
Well, I believe this will conclude our panel discussion. So all I have to say, farmers, join the NFO. Thank you.
This has been your NFO Midwest Farm Report, brought to you each Sunday on Channel 11 television by the National Farmers Organization, which is completing its 10th year as a major farm organization in its effort to improve the lot of every family-type farmer. The National Farmers Organization, Brown County Chapter, which sponsored this program, desires to thank the four public members of this panel for their thought-provoking questions and comments during this program. The National Farmers Organization desires to repeat that the appearance of the public members on this program does not constitute an endorsement of the aims and activities of the NFO, and similar views expressed by the panelists are their own and do not reflect necessarily the views of the NFO. The National Farmers Organization invites the members of the viewing public to send in their questions and comments regarding this program today, and assures the viewing public that all questions and comments received will be incorporated into the succeeding programs wherever practicable. And of course, the National Farmers Organization invites all producers who've not yet joined to investigate the advantages and benefits of joining in our members' efforts to improve the lots of every family-type farmer. Tune in again next Sunday at this time for another edition of your NFO Midwest Farm Report. The views expressed on the preceding program do not necessarily reflect those of the ownership or management of Channel 11.